We will also have someone here today to talk about the impact of the 2014 city budget on community programming.
I know there are huge Chinese population living in Scarborough. What's their the most concerned topics? Can you just give us some highlights?
I think, you know, lots of Chinese residents. I know for a fact that Chinese use the libraries the most in the city, actually out of all demographics. I think public libraries are a big value for the Chinese community. I also think that transit's another big topic for Chinese residents in
Scarborough. So how's the situation right now for transit?
The situation is not, for us here today, is not about whether we're building subways or, LRT. The situation here today is about whether City Council is continuing to fund the TTC or putting more of the responsibility on riders. So these bookmarks here will show that many City Councilors over the last 3 years have voted to take away TTC funding. And that has cost higher fares for all of us. 2014, we saw a $5 increase in the TTC Metro Pass, right? So higher fares, more crowding, more crowding, bunching, less service for people who are waiting for their buses.
Great. Can I have
now you're gonna hear Scarborough speak out. This is an event organized by Respect Scarborough. For those who don't know what Respect Scarborough is, it's a grassroots organization that was formed about 2011 to defend and improve public services for all Scarborough residents and strengthen Scarborough's economy by fighting to create more good jobs. In the months leading up to the Toronto 2012 municipal budget, city councilors were thinking about cutting transit service, libraries, daycare services, pools, recreation programs for youth and seniors. And what a group of Scarborough residents decided to do was to come together and say, no, that's not going to happen, and organize a series of events and build pressure to help reverse some of the decisions that were being put on the table. Ever since then, they've held more public events across Scarborough, talking to residents about their issues that affects them and providing facts about controversial issues such as transit. And today, we're here to let residents have a say about what they want to see in their city budget. And we have an amazing panel of speakers that will provide a bit of context with it. But then we also have a lot of time to hear from you. This event is also organized by Melbourne Action for Neighborhood Change, Wardywood Community Center, Public Interest, Birchmont Bluffs Neighborhood Center, Social Planning Toronto, Commitment to Community, and West Scarborough Neighborhood Community Center.
Okay. Thank you, Gulet. So I'll just introduce us. Gulet Arau. And I'm Carol Baker. We're both with Respect Scarborough. And I'm just going to briefly go over the agenda and give you an idea of how you can expect the evening to unfold. We're first going to have an overview. We'll be spending a little bit of time hearing about what's in the proposed budget, what it can mean, what it will mean for city services that Scarborough needs to invest in to have healthy communities. And then we will have a few guest speakers who will speak briefly on transit, libraries, and community recreation. Then we're going to have the bulk of the time devoted to you speaking out and talking about what Scarborough needs to see in this budget and how we can make these changes happen. So I'm going to first introduce Sheila Block, who is the Director of Economic Analysis at the Wellesley Institute. And Sheila is an independent nonprofit research and policy, the Wellesley Institute is an independent nonprofit research and policy think tank. Sheila is an economist whose research interests includes labor markets and public finance. She joined the Wellesley Institute in 2010 after more than 15 years of advocacy and research for organizations like the Ontario Federation of Labor and the Registered Nurses of Ontario. She's also worked as both a political advisor and public servant to the Ontario government. She has an honors BA in economics from the University of British Columbia and a master's degree in economics from the University of Toronto. So we welcome Sheila and thank her for coming out this evening to give us a bit of an overview of the city budget.
And also talk about one of the most kind of interesting things to me about city budget process, which is important to remember that there isn't a budget. IT systems, parks, something like that. The second budget that was actually passed is the rate-supported budget. And those are city services that we consider traditional, garbage, parking, and water. And then what we're going to focus on now is the operating budget. And so that's the services that we actually get day-to-day from the city. So what this just gives you is an overview of the almost $10 billion that is in the budget and gives you a little bit of a kind of breakdown about where those monies go. About 20%, or one in five of every dollar that's spent, goes both to the TTC and to transportation. So while transportation expenditures are roads and sidewalks, the TTC is that public transit. There's a large portion of the money that's actually in cost share programs with the province, and that includes public health, children's services, long-term care. About 15%, just over 15%, is for emergency services. And the part that we traditionally think of as municipal services, so that's the public libraries, parks, forestry, and recreation, licensing, is really just over 10% of the total. So that kind of slice of the pie, and we can think about where each of those dollars go or what shares of them go. And then because the city actually has to balance its operating budget, each of those dollars that are spent has to be matched by revenue. And the property taxes that we hear really far too much about from this administration, I think, make up only about 40% of the revenues. User fees are a large and important share. They're about 17%. And then there are other grants from other levels of government, both the federal and provincial government. But it's also interesting that these other kinds of revenues actually also are a fairly large share as well. So when we think about this and when we think about the kind of context for this about what do we need as a city, and I really think a starting point of any budget discussion, we really hope would go to say, what are the services that we need in the city and how can we pay for them? And one of the issues that comes up about this is the fact that unlike other taxes, like your income taxes or sales taxes, that automatically increase as economic activity increases and as population increases, property taxes by their nature don't. And so provincial or federal politicians don't have to get to increase revenues from those sort of tax sources, don't have to stand up and say, I'm going to increase your taxes by this amount. They automatically grow. And so when you try and think about, well, how are we doing on this year's spending? And there's a 1.5% increase in spending. You might think, okay, that's not bad. That's a way better starting point than we had for, let's say, the 2012 budget when there were massive recommended cutbacks. What we have to think about is, well, is that enough to maintain services for each of us? And to do that, we have to think both about the increase in costs and services and also the increase of people in Toronto. And so really, when we take a look at it that way, we see that, in fact, you know, we would actually need more services rather than less. And Jennifer, can you just flip that again? So, you know, if you're listening to the mayor or if you're listening to his brother, they think the only thing that really matters is how low that number is. Right, how low that tax increase number is. And it was really disappointing to me that the budget committee yesterday was really talking about how to shave 0.2% off the increase in property taxes when we had such a clear example over Christmas with the ice storm about how much we need city services, how much we rely on them, and really how much we need to invest. Just kind of another focus on how important it is to reinvest in city services, to address climate change, to address the needs that we have for TTC, to address the needs that we need for housing. So the mayor thinks, oh, you know, 1.75 versus 2.21, but really we have to come from a starting point of we are a growing, large, diverse, and complex city, and we need more services, and we need
And we also have to figure out that really our taxes are just like a gigantic Costco or something, right? It's a way of pooling our money together to buy things in a cheaper and more efficient way. There have been some estimates that the difference in tax, the tax rates that were being debated at Budget Committee yesterday would make a difference for the average household of about $13. And really, that would buy you a couple of fast food meals the next time the power's out and the kitchen isn't working. And really what we need instead is we need to kind of say, what can we buy by pooling that money together? What's the most, what's the best use of that money, and how can we use it really efficiently? So, you know, there's some good news in the budget. And the reason that there's some good news in the budget is that this is an election year. And I think what commitment to community that I'm involved with in respect Scarborough really think is we really have to leverage and use the fact that this is an election year to really both get as much as we can out of this budget, but also get some commitments from councillors and from other candidates about how they're going to approach things over the next 4 years. So we don't spend the next 4 years like we spent these years, basically kind of spinning our wheels, losing ground, wasting money as kind of one transit system gets replaced with another. So we do have some enhancements of services that are proposed in this budget, and that's really, that's good news. So I talked earlier about inflation and population growth, and if we just wanted to be back at where we were in 2011, before this whole kind of circus started, we would need to be spending another $365 million. That's just to keep per capita operating spending, real per capita operating spending, at the same level that it was before. And so that can be a little bit of an abstract idea, and make it a little bit more concrete on the next slide. So if you don't have those increases, then what you do is you have lineups for city services like the one there, because those services and the community services can't keep up with the demand of people's needs and a big growth population. We've seen funding for homeless prevention cut back, and we've also seen student nutrition programs falling short of what Toronto Public Health and the medical officer felt it to be. And so what's really great about this process is commitment to community went through a kind of consultation process that some of us were involved in before, earlier in the budget process, and came up with four key asks about investments in community services through the CPIP grant, about support for homeless prevention services and funding to support tenants, and about improving access to recreation and expanding student nutrition. And what's really great about that is that there actually has been some support for this so far and some success. And that's why that kind of community engagement in the budget process is both so important, but it's also really so fulfilling, because you actually can make a concrete impact on the kinds of services that we and all Torontonians get access to. So in terms of those asks, on the budget committee itself, there has been support for increasing the CPIP funding, there's been support for increasing the youth spaces, and there has been some support for increasing the student nutrition program. This is an interim measure, and what we really need to do is we need to keep up the pressure on our counselors. And I think two out of those four are actually counselors in Scarborough. And I did earlier today, I know which of those two were, but it's escaping me at the moment, but I'm sure you folks should talk for 3 minutes left. Okay. And so, what's really important about this is we just have a few more weeks, and over these next few weeks, we really need to focus and put pressure on counselors. At the back of the room, we have updated counselor profiles by the wonderful folks at Social Planning Toronto that give you information about your counselors and where they've been, where they stand, and where you can put some pressure on them. And you really, really need to get in touch with your counselor, both about this year's budget, but also to try and feel out where their commitments are over the next 4 years if they're running again. So,
now, to start us off on thinking about what the budget means for our neighborhoods in Scarborough, we've got a few speakers tonight who will speak for a couple of minutes to specifically address services that residents in Scarborough have said are priorities in the past. And I'd encourage everyone to use the sheets that we have, sheets that for points that you can make, the budget deputation sheets, which we're not, we're not formally doing deputations, but you can use these sheets to sort of capture some of your ideas when the speakers are talking, so that when we get to our Scarborough Speaks Out portion, we can really have a full discussion about everything. So I encourage you to use those sheets during this time. And our first speaker is Tim McGuire. He's the president of QP Local 79. He first became a Local 79 member in 1990 when he began working as a caseworker in the Employment and Social Services Division at the City of Toronto. Tim was first elected Local 79 president in 2011 after serving as first vice president, chief steward, unit officer, and lead negotiator for several of Local 79's bargaining units. He's currently coordinator of the Social Services Division Committee and co-chair of the Field Watch.
I actually have to go to another event, so if I pick up my jacket, it's not because I'm cold. But I want to start by reiterating a point that Sheila made, that the ice storm really should have been a wake-up call for people in terms of services that the city provides, whether it's at shelters, at funding for social services, at recreation, at public health, et cetera, people pulling together, and of course the QB1 members at Toronto Hydro and 416 members at the city providing services they provide, pulled together, and actually a lot of people went over above and beyond the call of duty to make sure that ongoing were taken care of during that period. On the other side, midway through 2013, after all the political consultations in the 2013 budget and the service levels set and the number of positions that are needed for their service level, 2,500 positions at the city and its agencies were left unfilled. That's a cut in services. That services that could be provided by hiring a staff as people leave, that could be moved, et cetera, and that wasn't done. So after the, like I said, the political consultations set the service levels, they're not done. And what really needs to happen in 2014 is what the service levels are set. The city has to be accountable to that and put in place whatever is decided through that process rather than continue service cuts. We recognize that the staff recommended budget for 2014 is more of a status quo budget with some service enhancements, some investments in some areas, and it's not the deep cuts that have been there over the past 3 years, and it's really important to recognize that those cuts have been accumulative, that the impact of one leads to the impact of the other. 2,500 positions in 2013 plus thousands of others over the past 3 years. So it's time that instead of cuts, the city should look seriously at investing in people, in Toronto neighborhoods, communities, to push to make Toronto a more livable city like it has been, and to make some advances. It's time to invest in children, in newcomers, in homeless, in youth, and to specifically talk about one area where there has been some support, some movement, that's in drop-in centers for youth and recreation community centers across the city. That recommendation actually came about through the Recreation Works campaign and the Commitment to Community campaign, actually consultation with youth and others around the city. So it's a legitimate ask that's come out of the communities in Toronto. It had some support at the budget committee, but then that there was actually a pullback on that at the budget committee yesterday. It's a legitimate ask, and you know how soon we forget. There has been violent incidents in various communities around the city over the past 2 years, and in consultation with the youth, the people that are affected, they come up with a recommendation for further drop-in centers, drop-in time at the recreation. It's really important for councilors to hear loud and clear that we remember and we need to put in place measures to reduce the risk of violence in communities and listen to the youth when they speak out and tell us what they need. So it's important to keep up the support on that. There are lots of other areas where the city could be investing in those communities. The residents of Toronto, of Scarborough, like other cities, those kinds of services. It's important to note that they also voted down an expansion of 16 new after-school recreation and care ARC programs that could have been put in place. And these new programs were to be located in Scarborough and North York. So it's important for the pressure to be put on to keep those recommendations. So I'll just end by not going into other areas where there could be investments. We're suggesting that people here tweet. Get out your phones and tweet. I live on Blank Street, whatever that is, to respect Scarborough. You need to respect city services. Go to recreationworks.ca, hashtag fuel budget, hashtag fuel home. So I'll end it there just isolating on that one area where pressure could be on to make sure that this is a good budget. Deliver those services and then doesn't fill the position. Or if they've set a service level and a number of people retire, or whatever the case may be, they don't fill those positions. So they set the service level and then they gap those positions to save money. In the fall, when they brought out the service levels for use and the wrap up for their 2013 budget, department after department after department showed that they were saving money by not filling essential positions and delivering the services. Public health, for instance, the highest, 224 positions. And that's a division which is often cost shared with the province in terms of those services. Some of the other divisions, planning. There are more cranes in Toronto now than at amalgamation, but there are less planners. There's less people approving building permits because of gapping. And I could go across the board. So again, it's when they budget for a certain number of positions and then they don't fill those positions. So we go through this whole political process around setting a budget, and then the city doesn't live up to what's been agreed at council.
Any other questions? We'll take one more.
Yeah, I'm really interested in this 225 public health positions that are gapping. What would these people be doing if they were actually on the table? I mean, what are we not doing in terms of public health because of the gapping?
So it's difficult to get into the fine points around what particular services, but in public health, they deliver the healthy babies, the healthy families programs. There's often the staff that are giving the shots that are happening now right in the building, et cetera. So public health nurses, various programs for families around the city, sexual health programs, et cetera. And I can't tell you now which of the 224 belong to which program, but they deliver very important services. One of the particular programs that overlooked this one, they actually, various language programs that reach out to newcomer communities to make sure that they're aware of all the programs that are available to non-voters. There are those that then say, including the mayor and his brother, that say then cut those positions because they were needed. They were needed. They were just deep service cuts over the past few years.
So everyone give a round of applause.
The librarian with 27 years service. She's been president of the per local 4948, which represents 2,100 library workers since 2010. She led successful 2011-2012 budget fight back campaigns, which stopped library closures and service reductions. And Maureen is working now to change the conversation to reinvest in libraries.
Good evening, everyone, and thank you very much for the invitation this evening and the opportunity for me to share my story about the library budget and also how it affects all of you out here in Scarborough. I have a cartoon that I would like to show you this evening, which will summarize the battle over the library budget back in 2011 and 2012. At that time, the Ford administration had introduced the KPMG review on core services, and the recommendation was that there would be 20,000 library hours cut. There was talk about closing up to 30 branches and so on. So through our campaign, with the enormous assistance of many of you who signed up for our campaign at ourpubliclibrary.to, we sent a very strong message to City Hall to stop the cuts, and indeed we did stop the cuts. And after you watch the video, all of you will get a bookmark that's distributed, and I can see Councillor Lee is at the back, and he was one of our champions in defense of the library budget, and his name. On this bookmark, and you will see in our cartoon that he will be one of our heroes in defense of the library budget. This year there isn't as much of a crisis around the library budget. Yesterday at the the budget committee wrap-up, the library budget was approved at a 1.2% increase, and there is going to be including funding for the new library that's going to be opening in the fall out here at the Scarborough Civic Center. And the other service enhancement that is going to take place is the standardization of hours at the district branches. And for those of you out here in Scarborough, that means Albert Campbell District and Agent Court Library will be getting a few more hours. So if they were to open Friday night to Monday morning, they will now have those hours, so all the the big libraries across Toronto will be the same. And I guess just before we watch the cartoon, the last thing I'll leave you with is that there is a very important political message in here, and that we want to elect a strong council, such as Councillor Lee, who is in support of library and many of the other issues that you've been hearing about this evening. And after we watch the cartoon, we've got one special, I hope, fun thing for us to do. So watch the cartoon and enjoy it, and then we'll get to that. Thank you.
Toronto and its people have a lot to be proud of. We are one of the world's great cosmopolitan cities. One of the reasons is our truly great public library system. Since 1883, a vast reservoir of human knowledge and imagination has been shared with every part of our city. We have the busiest library system in North America by far. 19 million visits a year, more than attend Toronto's top 10 attractions combined. Newcomers to the city quickly discover this great public asset for learning, for pursuing their dreams, for preserving links to their cultural and linguistic heritage, and for informed professional advice. All this and more for just 2 cents of every city budget dollar. That 2 cents, however, seems quite a lot to some politicians who have been hacking at the library's resources for the past 20 years. They have cut our library to the bone. Fewer books are being added. Toronto's unique urban affairs library has been closed. Literacy programs, even for children, have been cut. Children's librarians eliminated. And despite the growth in Toronto's population and an even larger increase in library usage, service has been cut. Today, there are 25% fewer staff than 20 years ago. Our library is falling behind. Many politicians seem to have no problem with this. In 2012, 21 city councillors, led by the mayor, voted to slash the library budget by a devastating $17 million, on top of the millions in cuts from previous years. Thankfully, 22 councillors stepped up and said no. They were backed by a spontaneous public uprising against the cuts. Tens of thousands protested online and in person to save our public library from such short-sighted politicians. So here's the question. What will happen in the next city budget? Some municipal politicians continue to ignore the wishes of the people they were elected to represent. Sadly, kowtowing to Mayor Ford seems to have become more important than standing up for their constituents. There's lots of talk these days about our city's neglected infrastructure, our public transit, water system, hydro, and many other shared assets need renewing for Toronto to remain a great city. But that's not all. For the economy of the future, our city's knowledge resources, our intellectual infrastructure, is just as crucial as the rest, perhaps even more so. We cannot move forward if our knowledge base lags behind. Toronto's public library system is the great equalizer, because it's open to all, regardless of income or background. Just a handful of pennies daily would give our library what it needs to properly serve its owners, the people of Toronto. Those who came before us understood the timeless value of the public library. Let's learn from their wise decisions. Join us and stand up for our public library. We need more than a one-vote margin to save and renew it. Tell our civic leaders that the time has come to reinvest for ourselves today and for those to come tomorrow. It's easy to join this movement. Visit ourpubliclibrary.to. Do it today.
Budgets and the budget in Toronto in general. And as a message going forward, all of us together can make great change. And thank you for being here tonight, because you're showing your support for being part of that conversation. So thank you.
Especially the lively part at the end. And Councillor Lee, unfortunately you weren't in the room when I introduced you last time, but we thank you for coming out this evening. Our final speaker before we get into our group discussion is Bob Kinnear, who is the president of the Amalgamated Transit Workers Local 113. Coming off the shop floor in 2003, Bob Kinnear was elected as the youngest ever president of the Amalgamated Transit Union Local 113, and he's been re-elected three times, the last time by acclamation. Under Bob's leadership, Local 113 has led the fight for more transit funding from all levels of government, health and safety for both workers and riders, and has campaigned relentlessly against transit privatization, which has not worked anywhere in the world where it's been tried.
Talk about such an important issue as public transit is. Not only is it important for me from a representative perspective, obviously my interests lie with the workers of the TTC, but I also come at it from a different perspective. And that is someone who has always had to rely on public transit all of their life. Fortunately, I'm in a position now where I can afford a car, but I never forget those days hopping on the only car we knew when I was a kid, which was the streetcar, and with my mom and my sister. So I recognize the importance of public transit to the people of Toronto, particularly the people that don't have other resources or other avenues for transit. So it's a very important issue. I don't have to tell the people of Scarborough how important this issue is. It's been a little unfortunate the last year or so. Scarborough has become a bit of a political pawn between the municipal government and the provincial government. Quite honestly, both levels of government have botched this file. The reality is it started with the provincial government in the mid-90s under Mike Harris when they cut substantial funding from the TTC. Prior to 96, the provincial government allocated 50% of the operating costs to the TTC, which ensured that the users of the TTC would not continuously face increases as we have over the last couple of years. There is a great importance to keep transit affordable for the people of Toronto. And, you know, quite often you'll hear the rhetoric from people that don't utilize transit. Well, I don't use transit. Why should I have to pay for it? It should be the users that pay for transit. The reality is that there's not a study out there that doesn't reflect the fact that transit is important for all people of the city, whether you utilize it or not, whether you step foot on it or not. If you're a businessman trying to operate a business within the city of Toronto, traffic congestion does not prove your business. When you have people getting out of their cars onto the subway and the transit, it makes your company more efficient, which enables more profitability for that company. So the reality is that it's beneficial to everybody. One point I do want to make, though, is that we are the least funded transit system in North America. There is not another public transit system where the riders pay more of a percentage of that operating cost. In Toronto, currently, it's about 75%, which means the people getting on are paying 75%, the city government's subsidizing to the level of about 25%. Comparable to other cities, even within Canada, Montreal's at about 50%. Vancouver's at about 45%. So the riders incur substantially higher costs than anywhere else, although our fares are still relatively comparable to those other cities. So that's a reflection on how efficient we deliver public transit in the city. You know, you've heard a lot about the mayor. He's talked a lot about the fact when he was first elected, oh, don't worry, the private companies will come in and they'll build all this wonderful transit for us. Not true. And I think that that's been proven very clearly. He talked a year about that they're going to be lining up and nobody has shown up. Because the reality is that privatization within public transit has not worked anywhere in the world. Our organization has done substantial research in both Europe Canada, and the United States, and we have yet to find a system where it was beneficial to the taxpayers of that city or that municipality. So this sort of mirage that somehow we're going to reinvent the wheel with a 3P or a private-public partnership, as they like to characterize it, is just simply not true. The reality is, though, is that we need money. There's no doubt there. And it's disheartening that more politicians aren't talking about that reality, because it is a reality. Now, we have a choice. We either invest as taxpayers, or we have the private sector come in, make those investments, and then we will have to pay them at a substantial return. The bottom line is that at the end of the day, we will end up paying for it. And hopefully, and I'm cautiously optimistic, as we enter into provincial elections and municipal elections, that we will have politicians out there that are going to come out and convey the truth to people about public transit and the importance of the investment that we make in public transit. The reality is that investment will pay off. When people can move around, so from a financial perspective, for corporations, companies, there's a benefit to reducing the congestion. There's also, obviously, an environmental benefit to the people of Toronto. Even the OMA says that there are literally thousands of people that die in the city of Toronto due to asthma or other respiratory problems due to the emissions being spewed into our atmosphere. So we could actually save through our healthcare systems if we invested more in public transit. Not to mention the social value of public transit. As I started out by saying, I was a child that relied on public transit. That was how I got to go see my dad and my grandmother on the weekend. And it's very important that we maintain that. So just in closing, and I spoke just a tad longer than I probably should have, we're gonna show you a 90-second video that we have, and it's called The Truth About Transit.
By another name. Great idea. Let's give away the TTC. That way the government gets to shift the blame when the public complains about transit. Those corporations accountable to no one get access to billions of our tax dollars. What do we get? Yeah, remember us? The riders? Longer waits, skyrocketing fares, just like the 407, decreased safety, some partnership. Need proof? Look at all the other cities paying the price for privatizing transit. It's a long list. Vancouver's P3 Canada Line cost BC taxpayers millions and actually reduced transit services in much of the city. Or take the privately run York Region Transit with the highest fares in the country, huge taxpayer subsidies that go to Europe. We don't want this for Toronto Transit. Canadians know that some things should stay public and not be driven by corporate profits. So help spread the truth about P3s. Let's not just give away our public transit system. There's just too much to lose.
So here in Respect Scarborough, working with ATU, we've made amazing bookmarks to show on two different votes how Scarborough councillors voted when it comes to investing in transit. So take some. Give it to your workplace, give it in your neighborhood, and let people know as we move into our municipal election where our councillors stood when it came to public transit in Scarborough. At this moment, we have time for a few questions before we move on to the portion where we hear from you folks about what you want. But you have a couple questions if anyone has any questions for anyone that's on the panel right there. So if you have any questions, just raise your hands. Wow, we posted an amazing job. Only two questions.
No specific question.
Awesome. At this point, we want to provide the opportunity for you to speak out and share your thoughts on the proposed budget and what you want to see as an investment for your community. So everyone will have a few minutes to speak out, say what's on your mind, and we'll go from there.
Mm-hmm.
So if anyone has any thoughts to share or has any opinions about the budget being proposed or things they don't like, things they want to see, this is the moment.
This is your moment.
Yes, sir.
And this is about the library and the 2 cents.
stood there for an hour and a half before anyone stopped to pick up a penny. And it was a kid, of course. And 2 cents per day was the difference between what the library needed to stay level with what it had been after the last 2 years and what the council was proposing. So when councilors would get all exercised, they would blow up that 2 cents to $1 million or something. They were talking about something that people would not even stop and pick up. And that's the sort of the truth about how politicians can manipulate numbers. All we needed was 2 cents a person per day to maintain the library, to maintain it. But it wasn't enough to stop people. Try it yourself. Get a call.
Thank you. Did anyone else have any thoughts to share?
Who do we believe? How do we kind of address that these are all fake numbers coming from one group of councillors at City Hall, and just they're just lying one after another? So how do we address that situation?
An easy question to start with, eh? I got to tell you, I mean, I'm well versed on the file, but from time to time, I'm even confused. When they start talking, and quite often, they will start mixing operating budgets with capital budgets, and I think that Sheila touched on that, the difference between that. So right now, they're talking a lot about capital budgets. When they talk about expansion, that's the capital infrastructure that the province is providing. As far as the actual costs on one line in comparison to another, a lot of times it's subjective. I mean, you're trying to project a cost for, you know, potentially billions of dollars. It's very difficult to get to a specific number on what the actual cost is. How do you eliminate that? I've got to tell you, I don't have a very clear and decisive answer for you. I wish I had. What I do know is that they are not talking about the whole picture. And the analogy I often use when we talk about the capital expenditures going to be invested in Scarborough with the new lines, whichever way we end up going, is that it's like building a house that you can't afford to heat or provide water in. That's what they're doing. We are building a house that we have absolutely no resources allocated to ensure that there's heating and water in the house. And what I mean by that is the operations of the transit. Public transit is not a profitable industry unless you want to charge people $6 and $7 to get on a vehicle. Or you reduce service to a rush hour service only, which has all kinds of implications on the community. So I don't have a clear answer for you. I wish I did. I would, as a resident, encourage politicians to talk about the whole picture. How, once we get the new lines, are we then going to pay for the operations of those lines?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I don't know if I should stand up. My name is Sharon Baltry. I run the Park Trans Association of Scarborough Village. I'm a lifelong resident of Scarborough for over a half century. I don't know really what's going on here in terms of how well advertised, first of all, that you've advertised this meeting, but I've counted there's only 50 seats here out of all of Scarborough that you're anticipating to have a crowd out of, so I'm very surprised by your anticipated numbers here, number one. But number two, with the city amalgamation in 1998, and that for the past 30 years, and that it's been a city planning policy in that to actually turn Scarborough into a ghetto, and that, so if you're looking for funding, and that we are always being used as a piggy bank for the other wards, so I certainly think the city of Toronto could actually look at the actual spending numbers out here. It would have more than enough money to come up with the infrastructure, because we actually have had our communities raped and that since the 80s. So I would like to know how much money actually we are talking about in terms of budget, because it's all, you know, it's all very up in the clouds, but we don't see any concrete numbers. And whenever we're contacting, you know, the city councilors and everything for actual copies of the budget in terms of what's being spent per ward or per community. We can never get any answers. So I would like to know here, in concrete terms, who I can get in touch with to get a budget and that for Scarborough Village, for example.
I would say certainly you can begin with your own local councillor.
Right, I've met with Councillor Gary Crawford.
Right.
He has not been forthcoming with any budget.
I would say in some ways that data would be difficult to get at word by word.
Well,
I will just make one comment though, and it's a personal comment for myself.
Right.
I started off in the Etobicoke Public Library. I lived in the old city of Toronto, but I began my career in the Etobicoke Library. And my perception back then was, however you want to call them, and I will just say, personally, I live in Toronto, and my Toronto is everybody. I don't talk about the different areas anymore, but if you go back to pre-amalgamation, the outer rims, if you want, the suburbs, however you want to characterize them, in general, those budgets were lagging far behind the city budget. And the old city of Toronto put a lot of money into services, and now we've been in the difficulty of trying to raise those levels up everywhere for it to be comparable for everybody across the city.
I disagree. I don't even recognize Scarborough anymore, and this is not the same city it used to be, and that pre-amalgamation and that and after, and anybody who lives out here will disagree with you.
I'm not saying it's different.
No, our services out here have been completely raised. This has been going on as a steady policy, and that was the city of Toronto, and that where they're putting all the immigration out here, it's not being distributed across the city, and that we already know that's a model that doesn't work. And that
I'll just say for the library, that I can speak to specifically, the level of services out in the Scarborough Library was far less than some of the other libraries at amalgamation.
Scarborough Village doesn't have a library.
For the purpose of this event, to move forward, if we could please not have people talk over one another or...
that's fine, but even in terms of TTC, and that you can look on the record, and that I call TTC at least once a week regarding the 102, and the fact that it's servicing Centennial College, and the numbers on there, and how, you know, we're actually put onto the buses, you know, that are coming two and three together with cattle prods practically, and they will not put any extra services on there. People are always being late for work, late for school, and that losing their job, and that because we don't have the proper infrastructure out here.
Thank you so much for your comments.
Right.
So
there is funding. It's just that our funding for the past 3 years has been spent for other boroughs. So I'm just trying to state that we do have the funding if you go back through the records.
You should let the woman finish before you.
No, because I would like to know where our funding has gone for all of these years. For 30 years, this has been going on since the 80s, and that not just since the amalgamation. It's just been definitely more noticeable, and that since the amalgamation. And that, but at least we had some services before. And even, for example, on that with the ice storm, if you think that the residents down in Gilwood would have had to have waited 2 weeks and that to get their power turned on, and that if we had our own mayor and our own budget, and that there's not a chance, and that it would have been handled completely differently, and that. So I would like to know if anybody is even looking, which councillors and that are looking at going back to reversing the amalgamation. So I do know some of them were discussing that before. And that, because this is not working for Scarborough being the part of Toronto.
So I think there's a lot of great points.
50, you're expecting 50 people here. I actually had this gentleman invite me. I didn't even see this advertised anywhere. Where are you even advertising?
Can I just say a lot of great points, but to be directed to councillors. Yes. And so we have one great councillor who's here to listen. Emily is here to listen, but I think what you're raising are points a lot of residents like myself and others are feeling and experiencing. And it's good to have them shared, but I think in terms of who's, the people you're naming to take action on are folks at City Hall. And so we'll...
Well, if City Council is voting, they're not doing anything.
So things that we should be, as a community, sharing with councillors like Chin Lee, absolutely. But otherwise, the panel, they don't work at City Hall. And part of this is to do some of the sharing, and so it's really helpful that as they're sharing information to us, we're able to share it back. And so I think it's really important that you share that with the rest of us. So when counselors are coming and talking to us, we can continue sharing that like you are.
Okay, well, I think one of the things
I think that there's a lot of alienation in Scarborough, but the reality is under Miller, more money was invested into Scarborough. That's why they identified six priority neighborhoods, which include Scarborough Village. Unfortunately, when Rob Ford came along, he cut about 20 bus routes in Scarborough, which is one of the deficiencies. So Transit City and Miller's transit plans would have alleviated a lot of crowding, but instead the formula switched from 47 people per vehicle to 53 people per vehicle. So that's why maybe in stints in Ford's way of trying to be more efficient or effective is that they're crowding more people onto existing vehicles. And their preference is for certain types of trains rather than what was originally planned and paid for. So you're going to have to understand that in the current mix, Toronto does benefit, but so does Scarborough. It's ultimately North York and Etobicoke that are a little unequal nowadays, because in the last few years, North York benefited more so because they stopped for subway routes just to do the Shepherd Stubway from Yonge to Fairview Mall, so people along there could go shopping.
People can find out how they can access the city budget, because that really hasn't been answered yet.
Yeah, Councillor Lee, we did want to give you an opportunity to speak, and certainly if you would like to address some of these issues, that would be, you've heard a number of issues raised, and we want to make sure you have a chance to share how we can invest in Scarborough through this budget.
Well,
can you come to the front?
To all this, again, I'll speak from here. I'm here to listen to what everybody has to say. And when you say investing in Scarborough, and when you say a fair deal, I always ask this, what do you mean by a fair deal? Because when you say that, should we be taking revenues and then dividing equally into all the different areas? It's not an easy thing to do, as Mark Kinnon was saying, all right? When it comes to budgeting and so on, you've got to take a look at needs, right? A lot of community housing is downtown. So a lot of the funding for community housing goes downtown. The mission starts and so on. Do we want it spread out? May not make sense. Right? So much of this is to do with the needs of each different community. Okay? And you're saying that Scarborough and Sonny Young there was saying that there were some cuts. Okay? Again, the people that elected for governor mayor wanted to see reductions, wanted to see savings. So again, this is a balancing of everything that people want. There are people that even now come forward and say that we should save at $13 a year by reducing budget increase, the property tax increase by 0.5%, which is a saving of $13 a year for the average household. And as this gentleman was saying, divide it up into the council to what, 4 cents a day?
3.5.
So why are we fighting over 4 cents a day? So that's why I'm supporting the 2.25 right now. To provide the services that people do. Now, to restore any of that, it's not an easy thing either. Because then you're asking people to pay more. So it's a balancing act. So many of these things that you'll be talking about, it's not easy decision. It needs a majority of councils to agree to it. That's 23 votes. And since this is election year, all of them are looking at the votes. So you got to elect, as we say, strong council who's going to do the right thing. Not just looking at votes. So you got to look at every one of us and say that what is his value. If
If I do run for your re-election, you would have to look at me as well. It's clear in my head. Does it align with your own? And vote accordingly. Because everybody have their own ideas. Mayor Ford says he wants to save $15 million. I say, show it to me. Don't just talk. Okay, show it to me. Give me some time to take a look and see whether it makes sense. Cut $15 million from the budget. Now, that's $15 million. Let's also talk about reducing land transfer tax. Where's that money going to come from? 10% of the land transfer tax is 5.35 million. So there's less revenue coming to farm. If you reduce it. You know, I did vote against the land transfer tax because I didn't think it was fair. But now that we have it, it's hard to remove it. I'm going to be honest with you, okay? So if we can find savings, we'll look for it. But in the end, we all have to, as city councilors, I represent one ward out of 44. So, you know. And if you take a look at this, I voted against some, I voted for some. It depends on at that time. I got to go to my restaurant and say, what are you going to accept? Because I'm there to represent people.
Where do you stand on the recreation for
recreation for New England Fish Park? There are many.
For children. For children who hang out on the street.
Okay, that one was supposed to be North Park. One was supposed to be school. Now, on that one there, I want to say that we have to work with the city to see how we handle it. Because if we start, again, we should look at see whether the property tax system should be used for that particular use, or should we be going after the problem to help. Because it's a social program, and as one of the participants here was saying, okay, they have downloaded on Earth by. So we have to look and see how we can ask for help out and fund some of that. And you're right, okay, I mean, many of young people don't know where to go. It's too hard. So we have to see what we have to do. And recently, we have put money back in the nutrition program. Okay, but whether we can fund all of nutrition, you know, and I also believe that parents have a responsibility to look after their own children. If you're going to have children, you have to look after them. Not just depend that point the government says that, hey, I have children. I cannot afford it. It's a balancing act.
If you have a problem with immigration, then, you know, people as individuals choose where they move and live. Yeah. And it's a federal responsibility. That's a federal profile. If you don't like immigration, then lobby your federal government. But I think that it's very offensive for me, and I'm really sorry. I just have to say something.
So my name is Andre, and I am a Scarborough resident, like, you know, 25 years. And I don't get the chance to speak out often, so I'm glad to have the opportunity. Even though there's only two people here, I'm glad to have the people to talk to about this. And I think for me, like, the transit issue is still a big issue. I just want to talk about it. Put it out there. It's talked about all the time. I've been part of so many meetings for many years, and we're still in the same place. I still take the same route. I take the 102, I take the 38, I'm still taking the same bus, the same amount of service, and nothing's really changed. So I just want to get it off my chest. That I know I feel the same frustration, and I see what's happening in the debates on City Hall and Ontario government, and we're not really getting anywhere. And yeah, North York gets four stops. We're still waiting for our 10 stops that we definitely need to make Scarborough, you know, a community that is vibrant and that can be connected and that we can feel proud of. Even though people say, yeah, Toronto is my, what is it? We say Toronto is my Toronto is everybody.
Yeah.
But I don't always feel that way. People talk about Toronto and all the cool events are downtown. All the cool things to do are downtown. Why aren't the cool things to do where I live? You know, why aren't the cool events I want to attend out here at Albert Camden Square? You know, that's part of this is for me that I've been missing for all my life. And I slowly start seeing small things happening, small festivals are popping up, Taste of Florence, Toronto Mela. The cool events are happening now. But I just want to see more, and I think the transit piece is a really big piece of that, because we can't get around the way we want to, so we can enjoy the things that you know, we all want to enjoy as people who are part of our city, at Toronto. So I'm always a proud Scarborough because I have no choice. I have to stand up for where I live. You know, I can't say I'm a proud Torontonian because I don't feel as proud to be from Toronto as I do feel about standing up for Scarborough. So that's my piece.
So I'm very familiar with the levels of service or lack thereof in Scarborough. I think that the problem in Scarborough is there's probably not an area of the city that's grown more. And if you look at the transit budgets over the last 3 or 4 years, it's been stagnant. Sheila's point, we've not even kept up with growth, inflationary rates. Just 2 years ago, the TTC actually had a surplus that was then reallocated back into the city coffers when it should have been reinvested in maybe some infrastructure, some capital expenditures, or the state of well-prepared. I understand your frustration out in Scarborough. I represent members that drive out to Scarborough. And it's gotten to the point where literally you can't carry the people. I think one of the problems is that we've never had the infrastructure in Scarborough to absorb the growth that Scarborough has faced, particularly over the last 10 years. So it goes right back to reinvesting in transit. And let me tell you, when they talk about transit cuts, where it hits is Scarborough. Scarborough has more surface lines, carries more people than any other jurisdiction in the area of the city. So when they talk about service cuts, they're talking about bus routes. That's what they're talking about. And that directly affects the people of Scarborough. I want to comment on the passion about Scarborough, and I understand that. But I also think it's important that we don't buy into some of the rhetoric coming out of City Hall that's divisive. That says, I'm from Scarborough, you know, you're from Toronto. Some politicians within the city council are perpetuating that. It's an us against them sort of philosophy. Don't give them the downtown line because that's for Toronto. Torontonians are, you know, people perceive themselves as downtowners, say, well, we should be investing in Scarborough. So I understand the feeling and the sentiment. I also resided in Scarborough in the early 90s, so I'm familiar with Scarborough. But I think it's important that we have the passion for the area of the city that we live in, but we ensure that we don't turn it into a divisive issue, because that is exactly what is going on at City Hall. They want the people of Toronto to be divisive. That enables them to perpetuate their bullshit programs or their bullshit philosophies, to be quite honest with you. And so I just wanted to throw that out there.
Thank you, Bob, for that intention.
And how do we change this discourse from waste to investment? Because investing in people is not waste of money. And how do you change that?
I mean, one of the interesting things about the Ford Brothers is that you have a little trouble with arithmetic. So also a public library, and the libraries will help them out a bit with it. So there have been, you know, a lot of analyses of the mayor's claims, or claims they say with $1 billion, and there's been a really clear analysis that that isn't the case. But I think your second question is actually the more interesting one, is why would we be saying that it's a good thing to spend less money on the services that we need so badly, right? And really the question is, why aren't we talking to our politicians and saying to them, you know what, we need these services. And we know from our life that, from everything in our life that there's no free lunch. You don't get services for nothing. There is no gravy train. And really what we need is we need politicians with really the courage to say, we understand that transit is really important to people who I represent in Scarborough, and I'm actually going to support an increase in investment and an increase so that the city steps up to the plate and actually puts those dollars on the table, makes that investment, and sticks to it, right? I mean, if you want to talk about ways changing your transit plans, when there are huge things that we call sunk costs, you're losing time, you're losing money, and you're making a bunch of bad decisions. a yawning need for investment. We have a huge need for investment, and we have interest rates that are at historic lows. And to be taking money, as this administration has been doing, out of the operating budget to fund capital investment is really the equivalent of saying to people, you really shouldn't have a mortgage for your house. You should be paying cash, right? We all know the difference. There's a difference between paying for your groceries on a credit card versus taking out a mortgage for your house. And at a time when we really have historic low interest rates, we really need a set of politicians to really step up to the plate, have the courage of their convictions, have a really honest conversation with people who live in Scarborough and people who live on all parts of the city to say, if you want better transit, you're going to have to pay some more property taxes. And you're going to have to pay for it, but it's going to be worth it because you won't have to run however many cars each family in Scarborough needs to get to work and to get to school. It'll be worth it because you're going to be paying less for childcare as your kids waiting for you to take that commute that takes so much longer. And really, this is the most efficient thing to do, right? And so really, it's about changing that conversation towards one, as Ashrat said, that it's one about investment. I want to say that, and I just want to kind of emphasize talk about how really disturbing I found the lady over there's comments about immigration. And it's
I'm going to clarify that.
I actually would really ask that you not clarify it.
Actually, I actually need to clarify that.
Kind of a racist remark.
It actually
I don't want you to talk over me. Sorry, I really don't want you to talk over me. And if you're going to have an apology for that remark, I think you should go forward. In other words, I really think that you shouldn't take up any more time here right now.
Actually, I'm next to speak. And
I understand
going to
that, but I'm
point.
Asking you to stop speaking because of how offensive I found your remarks about your immigration.
Actually, your personalizing is about letting
The same old story, it's a storybook, it's a line you give, but you do have the power to change things, and it's really, really basic. You hold the politicians accountable for their votes. Admittedly, as Councillor Lee said, there's complex issues, there's lots of issues. Easy for me on the one hand, I'm only worried about one thing. I'm worried about the library vote, so I can concentrate on that. But what is on the city website is the voting record for your councillors. And that's what the social planning booklets at the back from C2C highlight some of them. And people really do need to get involved and hold their politicians accountable for their decisions. And together we can change things. Doesn't happen overnight. It's slow, but I've been at this for a while, and I'm always amazed, no matter how big or small the room is, on how committed people are to this city and making this city work. And, I might be a Pollyanna or something, but we can change things if we do come together. And things like our campaign, it will give you the information, for instance, where all these budget forms are, as will lots of other areas. So you just have to find the area that you want, you're most comfortable getting involved with, and I encourage you to get involved. And we all got to get out and vote. And that's the main thing, and you'll be hearing a lot more, obviously, as we move into October. We're already hearing stuff on voting this year. It is truly important. It's our basic democratic right, and we need to exercise it.
$1 million, and they're continuing to cut it. If you have children and you're concerned about these things, I would advise that you call your counselor, email your counselors, let them know that cutting recreation budgets is the wrong way to go. The people that work for the City of Toronto in the recreation centers, if you've been there, they're overworked, they're understaffed. Tim talked about the gapping issue. It's a huge issue. And if that's a concern for anyone who lives in this city, please contact your counselors and let them know that cutting a recreation budget is the wrong way to go.
Wonderful to see everyone here, and as Dave mentioned, and as other people have mentioned, that this room needs to grow a lot bigger. I think one of the things we also need to remember is it is an election year, and mayoral race, it takes 23 votes to win any issue at City Hall, right? We tend to forget that all the time, and we have always, you know, we will likely focus on mayoral election campaign, but we cannot lose sight of the fact that we have to elect the right people, and you have to push those people and hold them accountable, as Sheila mentioned, and as others have mentioned too. And in order to do that, we got to form organizations in our neighborhoods, right? I mean, young people, you know, we need to form organizations, and we need to be organizers in our communities in order to achieve anything, and in order to push our politicians. And again, 23 votes. So it's not like mayor is just one vote at City Hall to do anything. So let's, you know, we just gotta get involved, and change can happen. So as someone said, Maureen said that. Absolutely.
Doing. So please don't leave, because Andre is going to talk after us. We just want to thank everyone for coming. Thank you for your commitment. Thank you for supporting the event. This is a total grassroots effort. It's 100% organized by volunteers. We do the best we can to get the word out and to do everything we can, and it's so important that people come out. So thank you for taking the time to come out. And I'll let Guled make any closing remarks, but Andre is going to close the meeting to talk about the next steps we take.
First of all, let's give another round of applause for our speakers. And thank you for sharing your knowledge with us tonight. And thanks again to Chin Lee for taking his time out tonight to come out. Tonight we heard many issues. We heard issues people had about transit, issues people had about recreation, issues people had about their libraries. But in order to actually turn these issues into action,
Scarborough? How about this? When I say respect, you say Scarborough. Respect?
Scarborough.
Respect?
Scarborough.
I didn't hear you. Respect Scarborough. All right, so what we want to do right now is something that's never been done before. We're going to do a flash mob. We're going to do a flash call. So in front of you, we have a list. Now, everyone who has a cell phone, can you just see your cell phone right now? Can you just please pull your cell phone out? If you have a cell phone, imagine we're at a concert right now and we're putting our cell phones in the air, you know? Cell phone gets lighter.
Yeah.
Can you see your cell phones in the air?
No.
All right. We're going to do...